Hello to you, friends. It's good to be reminded time and time again about the Dhamma. So I'll start more shares under the vlogs called Shortcuts, which will be recorded on small trips here in the forest. So let's do some rational reflection. There's this being alive. And what's the problem of being alive? That's suffering. If there was no suffering, no forms of suffering, neither physical suffering, aging, sickness and death, physical pain, or mental suffering, frustration, disappointment, fear, anxiety, and so forth, depression, confusion. There were no forms of suffering whatsoever. Then being alive would be no problem. But there is indeed many forms of suffering. And all beings that are alive, and in particular human beings, and lower than that, they feel significant suffering every day. So that's the problem of life, basically, suffering. Okay, we identified the problem, suffering. So that's seeing the first noble truth, dukkha. So how can we clear the problem of suffering in a rational way? Yes, then we have to obviously find out what's the cause of suffering. This can be mentioned as by several factors at several levels. If we say it's as two, then it's craving and ignorance. And if we say it within the framework of the Four Noble Truths, then definitely it's craving. However, why does craving arise? Because of ignorance. Ignorance of what? Ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. So, on the more deeper level, backing down on the causal chain until we cannot come any further back, then we see that ignorance, not knowing, not seeing, that's the cause of suffering. On the deep down absolute level. Okay. We're doing well here, huh? We found the cause of suffering to be ignorance. Avidya. Then, okay. Then it just means we have to get rid of ignorance. If we get rid of ignorance, then we also get rid of suffering. That goes without saying. Very nice place here. The small waterfall. I call it the temple. Now it's very small because it's drought. And actually I have to go down and correct the inflow to the hydropower turbine. I have a micro hydropower. And so it fits for a recording. Nevertheless, we're not here to talk about electricity generation in a responsible, clean way. We're here to talk about the cause of ignorance, which is the cause of suffering. So, once asked the Buddha this question, what is the cause of ignorance? And then the Buddha told him that the five mental hindrances, the nivaranas, they are the cause of ignorance. And what, friends, are these five mental hindrances? And how do they arise? And how do they cease? Is their habitual patterns of reacting to a given stimuli. So in modern psychology, in particular, the branch called behaviorism, then it's just stimulus response. Mine is just stimulus response. There comes a stimulus, there's a certain response. And this stimulus is habituated. This means it has come to be as a reactive pattern, as a behavioral pattern, because of reinforcement over a long time, doing the same thing in response to the same stimuli over a long time. For example, seeing food, then starts salivation, starting to be hungry. And here also, understanding this is also the key, actually, because habits can be unlearned, not only learned, but they can also be unlearned by specific training. However, it's, I would say, more difficult to unlearn a habit than to learn it. Because you can learn something unconsciously or subconsciously. But to unlearn it, then you have to be very aware. And not only aware, you have to be very skilled to direct the mind to the right place. So there was these five mental hindrances, and you can feed them, then they grow, then the ignorance also grow, or you can starve them, then they diminish, and then the ignorance they cause also diminish. And then the suffering caused by ignorance also diminish. So we are now close to the root of the problem. First off the bat of the five hindrances, Nivaranas, is Kamachanda, sense desire. What is the feeding, initiating cause of sense desire? It is irrational, careless attention to the pleasant aspects by a given object. For example, if you see a body, then you notice the pleasant aspect of this body. It can be the genitals, the breast, or the biceps muscles, or the penis, or whatever. The lips or the facial expression. And then one falls in love with this form. Same goes for cars, kinds of foods, forests, any kind of object. Careless, let the mind suck in only the attractive aspects, then makes this sense desire arise. Because when the attractive, pleasing aspects is noted, then the mind experiences pleasure. And then it causes a habit to redirect the mind to the same aspects again. Next time this object comes into the visual field or into the field of attention by chance. And so next time also there will arise a small pleasure, a small blip of happiness, and then it will reinforce this sense desire, this desire to have this object and enjoy this object. How then to unlearn this aspect? Yeah, then is to redirect mind to the displeasing, disgusting aspects with the same object. For example, instead of seeing a nice monk face, one says to oneself, inside this monk face is a monk skeleton head, a skull, huh? And teeth, and they will fall out and so on. So one sees the monk, one's own body and all bodies as corpses that fall apart. So under the skin here is obviously some flesh. If we took my skin off, or they took the skin of any porn star or any glamorous actor, then nobody wants to see these flayed or de-skinned bodies anymore. Not at all. They will look like horror movies and they will storm out of the cinema. So this one has to do, this one has to train. It's called asupa meditation, disgust meditation. Same thing with the food. When you see the food, you think of the disgusting aspects. This milk has come out of some glands of a cow that had eaten some food that was produced from pig excrement being spread out on the fields. Then there grows grass and then the cows come and eat it. Now you eat what basically comes from pig excrement. So one redirects mind rationally, forcefully, deliberately to the disgusting aspects, the asupa nimittas, with the same object that one was attracted by before. And then one, so this, instead of causing desire to arise, then it causes equanimity, upekka, a very peaceful feeling. So one is not addicted to sensing the object anymore. But it takes a considerable training. This means that one goes scot-free. One has come free of this addiction to sensing a given object. This also goes for sex, drugs, and rock and roll, money, power. They all have disgusting aspects, dangerous aspects. And it's seeing them and redirecting attention to them. The danger, for example, in having a body is obviously that you're going to be aging, sickness, and death. Huh? The teeth will fall out, you'll get cancer or a stroke or whatever. And it will end with an old being sitting in an elderly care home that is very much dependent upon other beings. So this is a danger in having a body. This one should note if one falls in love with one's own body. This happens especially when young, strong and beautiful, or if one falls in love with somebody else's body. This typically can be done in the cinema or looking at porn, for example, is the same thing. Falling in love with somebody else's body form, external form. Now we're down with this, almost down to the small hydropower station. So I think we take the next one after a short while, because this will be about ill will, vyapada, that arise because of why? Because of irrational, careless attention to the disgusting, displeasing, aversion-causing aspects of given objects. Then ill will arise. This is thinking about, for example, how irritating one's spouse is. Wrong patch in the jungle, begging out here, begging out of existence. That's what one should do. And then we take a new lane here, down to the hydropower station. So irritation towards other beings, one's boss, parents, misbehaving friends, spouses, children, colleagues or whatever, politicians. Irrational attention directed to their repulsive objects. That's what caused aversion, ill will, vyapada, to arise. When ill will, vyapada arise, then ignorance also arises, because you cannot see the Four Noble Truths when we are angry. Huh? When ignorance also arises, suffering also arises, right there, right then. And even more so when habitually entertained by more irrational attention to the displeasing, disagreeable, unacceptable aspects about various objects in reality. Thank you. Hydropower job finished, and back to the mental hindrances. So again, there's this ill will. It arises as a mental hindrance at the moment of irrational attention directed to the displeasing, unacceptable, disagreeable aspects, which are manifold, wherever you look, wherever you pay, whatever you pay attention to. Irrational, careless attention paid to these aspects make ill will arise. How then to starve this ill will? Yeah, this is done by universal friendliness. May all beings be happy. May they be free from anger. May they be free from their ill will.
May they thereby know the causes of happiness, and thereby come closer to happiness in each moment, in each life, and eventually by reaching Nirvana. So this is this universal friendliness, metta, cetta vimutti, the release of mind by friendliness. Redirecting the mind when becoming angry at the politicians or one spouse or the colleagues or the whole world or other beings in general. This cures this ill will, this anger. It fizzles out. Goes down. This one has to do again and again. Again and again and again. Then one forgets about it because of not having established mindfulness. And so, seeing something ugly or hearing about something wrong or being exposed to something that one dislike or disagree with, then one feels anger or ill will towards the object or the persons behind it. And then right there, ignorance arises, re-arises again, and it's reinforced, creating more future suffering. So, this universal friendliness, infinite universal friendliness, is what cures ill will, Wabaka. Next up is lethargy and laziness, Tina Mitta. It's the third mental hindrance. How does that come about? What does that, how is that fed or arising and reinforced? And this is again by paying irrational attention to this very same tiredness or sluggishness or laziness after two big meals or after having eaten, or when tired at night or when tired at the job, then saying to oneself, I am so tired, I have to lie down. So this agreeing and irrational attention to this laziness itself makes it grow even further, until one can only stay at the sofa as a being that are unable to go to work. And then one is imprisoned by one's own mind. And this happens for many beings, both male and female, very common. Suddenly, they cannot do anything. They can stop going to work, becoming jobless, then spending too much time on the sofa with too many videos and too much drugs. Then suddenly, they are caught up in laziness. That seems like a prison they cannot come out of. But they can come out. But a significant effort has to be done. What's this effort? This is redirecting the mind to three aspects: the element of initiative, the element of launching, and the element of endurance. These three aspects, initiatives, that's when you say to yourself, ah, now I have to do it. Before, you didn't even say to yourself you have to do it, you say, ah, I don't want to do it. But then taking the initiative, then one starts its chain. It's not enough to get you up from the sofa. That takes launching. This right when you say, ah, okay, now, not only do I want to do it, I will do it right now. And then swings the leg out the sofa and comes up. Or sits up again when having laid down. Sits up and sit and meditate again. Endurance instead, fulfilling the task, not stopping before it's finished. This is endurance. So, Tina Mitta, the mental hindrance of lethargy and laziness arises because of irrational attention to lethargy and laziness after meals and at evening times and when mentally fatigued. Goes away by rational, deliberately directed attention to the aspects of 1. Initiative, 2. Launching, 3. Endurance. This was the third mental hindrance. The fourth mental hindrance is the opposite of lethargy and laziness. This is restlessness and regret, remorse. This is a mind that keeps turning on some problem. It keeps coming back to it. Cannot solve it. Usually a transgression of the ethical standards, the moral living rules oneself has accepted at beforehand. Then because of fear, because of lust, desire, because of anger, aversion, opposition, then one transgresses towards these very same living rules that one has agreed upon. And then one later gets regret and remorse. And this causes restlessness because the mind cannot solve the problem. It keeps churning, keeps churning. So this restless mind has to be stilled. How to do that? Okay, this is when seeing the restlessness by the tool of awareness, sati, mindfulness, also called. Though mind has not to be full, rather mind has to be empty. Then seeing this restlessness, this churning mind, blah, 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 this internal chatter, churning on again and again, then one redirects the mind to mental tranquility and bodily calm. Mental tranquility and bodily calm. Again and again, one redirects the mind deliberately, carefully, and rationally to this tranquility of the mind, the sati, and calm of the body. Then restlessness and regret goes away. Gradually, as this habit of reinforcing it goes away. Last hindrance is doubt and uncertainty. How does doubt and uncertainty arise? This is giving irrational, callous attention to doubtful matters, speculative theories. This could be like this, could be like something else. Is the world eternal or not? Is physics like this or that? Is this or that possible? When did the universe start? Blah, blah, blah. Things that you cannot determine, but that you can determine in advance that you cannot determine them. And if you do that by paying rational attention to them, then you can redirect mind to some other aspects, namely the following questions. This thought chain I'm inside right now, is this advantageous or disadvantageous? This thought object I am entertaining right now, is this blameless or is it blameful? This mental state I'm in right now, is that exalted or is it ordinary or is it even primitive? Is that mental state I'm having now, I'm in now, is that on the light side or on the dark side? Again, this object and mental state that is present right now in this continuum of consciousness, is that advantageous or detrimental? Blameless or blameable? Ordinary or exalted? On the light side or on the dark side. Then this doubt and uncertainty, because of this re-evaluation and examination of the object and the mental state, was engulfed in. This doubt and uncertainty evaporate gradually, little by little. So these five mental hindrances of sense desire, ill will, lethargy and laziness, restlessness and regret, and doubt and uncertainty, they have kept us here in samsara for billions of billions of billions of universes, universal cycles, which each gives rise to billions of billions of lives at various positions. Usually on the lower floors. So these five mental hindrances, they have killed us a lot of times. Billions of times have they killed us. It is now up to us, friends, to say, okay, these serial killers, these five mental hindrances, they will not kill me again. Because I will work with hands and feet and all my might to unlearn these five mental hindrances by starving them, by not giving them attention, irrational, careless attention, but rather by learning these five tools of how to starve them, how to reduce them. From this very speech of a disciple of the Buddha, and thereby I'll come to go scot-free and deathless and happy and healthy and content. And so be it. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfect, perfect, note that, unsurpassably perfect, self-enlightened, was the best Buddha. And enlightened is also an option for us. It is not a romantic, superstitious belief in some unrealistic utopia. It's a real thing. It's a real state. It is somewhere forward in the future, if we do what remains of us. Thank you for your wise attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you.